Hello Smite fans, welcome to our second day of week number 5 of the Smite OPL. Today we have a clash of two teams, one at the top, one close to the bottom, Avant Garde up against Deadweight. Deadweight thus far unbeaten in the Smite OPL, and Lynx, they're looking to continue that streak today.
If I were to say at the start of the split, Deadweight are going to be the number one seed in the OPL, I would have laughed it off. Again, there's a reason why they are called Deadweight. They are the dropouts of other teams, and they've combined to make one of the most the most incredible teams I've seen in a long time, and they've been able to beat Pandemonium, which only one other team this split being inside has been able to do, and I'm super excited to see how they cast them today as well as the rest of the split.
We're going to head into picks and bans here, folks. Avant Garde going to be the first pick here. I expect to see them play something very vanilla, very much to their own strengths. You know, Liquid Renegade playing something tankier in the jungle, like a Thor, or even a Bologna he's found some success on. You know, Rob Diggity to play like a Hoi or Jingwei. Chuckles to play something out of the solo lane. I think he could play something that could carry, but he's really going to have a tough time of it today. Kabrakid, the first ban by Avant Garde. Raijin immediately banned away by Deadweight.
Yes, the Kabrakid ban from Avant Garde is straight away targeting Shred. His Kabrakid has now become infamous within the Smite OCE scene, and they just want to have none of it whatsoever. And the Raijin ban just banning out a very strong mid lane god.
So, Deadweight, as you mentioned, the cast loss of a lot of other teams, Guan Yu banned away by Avant Garde. I think the big catalyst for this team has been only good at solo. Previously, a solo laner, big surprise there, has moved into the jungle and proven his own name wrong and really been a driving force for this team. He's also the captain of this squad as well, so perhaps, you know, he's developed a little bit of leadership potential as well. Susanoo now banned away by Deadweight.
Yes, just getting rid of Susanoo. Deadweight were able to use Susanoo very effectively last week in the mid lane on Agony, but they know how strong he can be, how mobile he is, and if you don't have a way to cripple him, you basically have to ban him out or risk just getting destroyed in the early game. Athena will be your first pickup for Avant Garde.
Yeah, so the Athena pick I really like because that can either go in the solo lane for Chuckles, who really likes it, in the jungle for Liquid Renegade, who likes these more frontline characters, or in the support role for Gruff. So a big flex pick here for Avant Garde, not tipping too much of their hand. Nemesis and Hoi picked up for Deadweight here. Again, some really strong picks for them. You know, Nemesis can be played in the solo lane or in the jungle for Deadweight. Hoi, though, that's going to be going straight towards HS in the AD carry role, as Hornbarts and Scylla are now picked up for Avant Garde.
Yes, the Scylla is an interesting pick. Mouse is more known for his Yanis, and I would think with Yanis on the board and an Athena, you would consider maybe you won that global presence, but the Scylla can output a ridiculous amount of damage, especially now that you can go the Soulstone Purple Pot start and have level 1 easy lane clear. Barkus is now going to be the lock-in for Deadweight, looking to counter Avant Garde.
So Weave was famous in the ranked community for always wanting to pick Barkus. Even this was before Barkus was really kind of brought back into the meta. He's just like, just pick me Barkus. Like, we'd be first pick, there'd be some really OP things available. He's just like, just pick me Barkus. I want Barkus. So this is definitely a comfort pick for Deadweight. Raven banned out by Deadweight. I like this, taking it away from Chuckles, you know, taking away something he can survive on, get to a stage of the game where he can carry his team. Vermana now banned away by Avant Garde from Shred.
You can see straight away, as you said, they're trying to get rid of all the options for Shred, and now Avant Garde actually banning out the Bologna, just denying Chuckles if he wants, or possibly, you don't very often see it, put El Chuckles possibly on the solo lane on Hunt Bats, and then deny Liquid Renegade his Bologna, just to be on the very safe side and ensure that they can't get into their comfort picks.
It's definitely a ban away from Liquid Renegade. To be brutally honest towards Avant Garde, they haven't found that much success this season, but when they have, it's when he's played that Bologna in the jungle, or where he's played something similar to that in the jungle. Soul banned away by Avant Garde, trying to take away from Agony's God Pool. Janus, though, is going to be the pick here for Deadweight, and I really like this. You know, it's a semi-response to Avant's global presence with the Athena, as Janus portals will allow him and the rest of his team to get across the map very rapidly, but it also is something that just puts out a lot of damage.
Not to mention, they now have three different ultimates for objective secure. They have the three space and time, they have the intoxicate, as well as the sunbreaker. So if Avant Garde tries to be cheeky on objectives and they just miscalculate, expect Deadweight to basically just sweep in and take an objective underneath their feet.
So we see Amaterasu and Cupid locked in by Avant Garde, and the final pickup here for Deadweight is going to be Hercules. So Hercules in the solo lane. I really like this on Shred because what he's been very successful with for Deadweight is just being an absolute monster front idler, just running at the enemy team, stopping them from regressing on his own teammates. Hercules, something that has very high survivability, obviously with the tremendous amount of heals he had, but as well as that, his disruptive ability with his one and his two, just so insanely powerful if you can land those skills.
Well, last week we actually saw Shred did play Hercules in game number one and was able to do a really good job. As he said, he was literally just running at people using his mitigate wounds, and also he decided to pick up a Gauntlet of Thieves and just boost his healing even more, so he could just basically be constantly healing off the damage he's receiving and just be that annoying presence that solo lane warriors are known to be.
I like the Bluestone Pendant here as well. The pickup early is going to allow him to have a bit better wave clear than a Hercules normally does. It can, you know, potentially allow him, once he starts getting towards later stages of the game, just using that Driving Strike to clear the waves rather than having to use it in combination with the Earthshaker, and save the Earthshaker to disrupt something. Well, it's basically a saving mana kind of thing, but then also saves the Earthshaker to, you know, prevent abilities and, you know, disrupt Chuckles' own abilities.
And also, not just Chuckles, if you can catch a Mouse out with that Earthshaker Driving Strike combo, that will easily put him below 50% health, and if his purification is not up, he is just going to get melted by the sight of Deadweight. Deadweight always drives lineups that basically force people out of position into unfavorable teamfights, and this lineup is no different. There's so many different tools to get you out of position or put them in a better position to fight.
Let's take a look a little bit here at Avant-Garde's team composition. I really like the Athena-Scylla combination. We saw it from Corviday yesterday when they're going up against Insight. They found limited success with it, but overall, it's still combined to put out a lot of damage from the Scylla in the mid lane. If they could get a couple of those combinations off, they don't even need to combine it with the Armor Monster Ultimate. As long as you get it with a Crush, it should be really powerful for Avant-Garde.
Well, you can combine it with a lot of ultimates, not just the Iron Monster. Combine that, let's say, with the Fiend or Evil, get a 3-man taunt to a Fiend or Evil into a Field of Love, which cripples, which actually can really put a dent in the side of Deadweight, who needs to be able to get away and put themselves in a better position. And then basically in this early laning phase, what Avant can look to do is get that taunt, get a free Heart Bomb off, and get that free 180% scaling that if you get the two instances to hit.
I'm kind of surprised that Gruff's gone Mark of the Vanguard here early. While Mark of the Vanguard has been buffed recently and buffed, you know, tremendously, I still think Watcher's Gift is such a powerful item. The only reason, well, one of the reasons I can see why you pick up on Athena is that, yes, you might lose a lot of farm, but you could farm a little bit easier than a Valkyr, because you've got a little bit more mobility and you've got more of a global presence, as we mentioned, with the Defender of Olympus. So, you know, you might not lose out too much on that farm, but still, I think a Watcher's Gift overall is just so much of a stronger item.
Well, the problem is with the Mark of the Vanguard, that's kind of going to force Gruff into that Traveler's Shoes, really, because you're not getting that bonus last hit gold from having the Watcher's Gift passive online. And not to mention, also, he'll be having a lot less mana regeneration, as he just, again, the passive of Watcher's Gift just allows you to have that kind of regen. The Mark of the Vanguard, however, does give him that extra bit of HP 5, which might keep him alive in teamfights, as well as that extra bit of physical protection against a Hoogee who does a lot of penetration.
Oh, over in the solo lane, first blood as Shred solos El Chuckles there. That is something very rare to see. Indeed, as usually Chuckles is the one soloing other people.
I've said it past in the before, Shred has just such an aggressive, incredible presence in the game. He will just charge at you, and if you don't know how to react, as you saw there, he will just melt you down. And since I'm guessing, as we can see, Shred has used most likely the boulder, that means he basically just unloaded his entire combo into the Amaterasu. And even though Amaterasu does have that Heavenly Reflection to try and give a bit of extra protections, that just was not enough to deal with Shred in the early game.
Yeah, he pulled him out from underneath his own tower, driving strike back, and then as Chuckles dashed back under his tower, just as he said, unleashed that boulder on him and flattened out the Amaterasu. So just quickly back on the Athena Mark of the Vanguard point, it's actually a good point that he's going to have to go the Traveler's Shoes. When you're playing a Bacchus, you probably don't really want to go those Traveler's Shoes. You're better off going with the Pen Boots just to output extra magical damage for your team.
Yeah, we saw yesterday with Insight and Corviday that Biggie was really like outputting a huge, humongous amount of damage, and all he needed was a Shoes of the Magi as well as a Soul Reaver. And Weaver's also quite the aggressive support. He likes going in deep. We've seen him play gods like Amaterasu, Guan Yu, Athena. He just likes being that presence, the guy really doing a job to, basically by peeling for his frontline, he's doing the damage instead of actually just peeling.
I have to say, Weaver's definitely been the player that's impressed me the most of this split. Like, you know, as I said, he was in my ranked games. And if you know, you're in my ranked games, it's probably not a good sign. But he's definitely stepped up to the plate. And whether that's, you know, he's improved a whole lot or he's just always this good and never been given a chance is yet to be seen. I think it might be a combination of the two. But he's definitely proved his worth. He got a solo going a bit aggressive here on the Mouse, who just uses the Sentinel to get away. A Mouse with a Power Pot's been able to farm pretty efficiently here. He's actually ahead of Agni in terms of experience. But there's the Divine Judgment and the Intoxicate Mouse. Nowhere to run here. Weave picks up the kill.
Yes, that's the absolute power of Barkus there, as he saw that knocker made it impossible for Scylla to use the purification. By the time she came back down, it was all too little too late. Agony also doing a great job using that portal as well as the unstable vortex. Just output that early game damage, even though Giannis is known more for his mid-game damage, even early on, he is still a very massive threat. And if you get hit by two of his abilities, you're most certainly going down.
Well, his 3's threshold gives him additional scaling on his abilities. You know, at level 1, it gives you a 20% extra scaling on your unstable vortex, which already has a 70% scaling. So that is just an insane amount of extra damage you're able to put out with things like unstable vortex.
And also, what I'm probably going to look to see Agony go into is the Duel, simply because he has those portals to play a little bit more safe than most other mid laners who rely heavily on dashes or abilities that aren't as safe and mean you'll be losing the Duel stacks much, much more often. I'm probably going to see this game, the Scylla, most likely go into possibly the Doom Orb as well. But if we see Deadweight's aggression as we've been seeing from the last couple of weeks, I think Mouse may have to change up the strategy if he wants to go Doom Orb.
Gruff's looking to ultimate here. Liquid Renegade hiding over a wall, just looking at Shred here, who's just staring down El Chuckles. I don't know if he sends this one out or not, but Avantgarde just unwilling to pull the trigger at the moment. They don't have Shred in the position that they want. Wave is here now. Liquid Renegade comes around the corner. There's the Fear No Evil. Shred silence out. Here comes the Dazzling Offense. But there's the Boulder. Shred just staying alive for now. But Liquid Renegade picks up the kill. Successful gank there from Avantgarde, but they did just drop 3 ultimates into that solo laner, so immediately Deadweight, as is pretty, you know, par for the course, rotating towards the Gold Fury.
However, Avant knows exactly what's going on, and they've already got the presence there. Chuckles and Mouse trying to bring up the fight. Divine Judgment was with force there, as well as the 3 space in time, trying to alleviate the pressure so they can possibly look at this Gold Fury, but they're just going to reset, go back to the mid lane, and farm up a little bit more.
Yeah, so if we take a look at our graphs here, we can see it's a 700 experience difference, 700 gold difference in favor of Deadweight at the moment, unable to get that Gold Fury. And, you know, perhaps the biggest thing about that kill there for Avantgarde wasn't, you know, necessarily a gold or experience advantage, but it was just more just like a psychological thing. Like, you know, these guys, the top dogs, we haven't done so well, but you know what? We can play. We're still good at this game. We can compete with these guys.
Not only that, they're just taking away farm from Shred, and whenever we see Deadweight play, Shred always seems to come out into that mid and late game the most farm, just seemingly always able to be at least 2 or 3 levels ahead of the solo laner. So if you can shut him down this early, make him have to play a little bit harder for his farm, and just actually make him think, play it just out of his playstyle, that could really change the Deadweight dynamic and possibly make it a lot easier for Avant to try and take a victory.
Looking at Mouse at the moment, he's got 800 gold in hand. He hasn't backed yet, right-hand side mid-camps are up, so he's going to look to contest these along with his team. You were saying before he could possibly go the Doom Orb. I really think that it might be the Dynasty Plate Helm, as he's actually just completely eliminated here by the combination of Only Good at Solo and Weave. You know, the Divine Judgment and Intoxicate both use their Mouse. No chance at all. He's actually going here for an Uncommon Sash, so, you know, perhaps looking for a Warlock Sash just to get some extra health online for himself. If he's not going to get enough farm, though, it's definitely got to be an Ethereal stuff.
I'm thinking more towards the Warlock Sash, simply because I can foresee Avantgarde wanting to play more towards that mid to late game. And if he can get those stacks up on the Warlock Sash, he'll be in a very comfortable place. As he saw that in that fight, Only Good at Solo with the Divine Judgment, even at level 2, I think that would be now, he basically was able to take away 50% of your protections. That's the recent change in like most recent patches, as well as a percentage base of your health. And percentage base really hurts Scylla more than an actual number, because essentially she's just going to get absolutely just decimated straight away, as you saw, just thanks to the belly flop and everyone else coming in.
It's hard as well to try and get that Sentinel off to get away when you're knocked up. There's nothing you can do. You can't even purification away that CC. You essentially have to do it beforehand. So Mouse either has to anticipate that the knockup is coming or suffer through the damage while he's knocked up in the air before he can get away.
Speaking of Barkus, we can actually see he's going into a Mark of the Vanguard third item. And we've been seeing this a lot from iRapper lately when he was at DreamHack. Basically, picking up those two actors, giving you that nice little extra bit of protections as well as that extra little bit of health only for 800 gold.
Well, it's super efficient as well. For 750 gold, you get the starting levels of both Sovereignty and... gosh, what's the other one? This is really bad.
Heartwood Amulet?
Heartwood Amulet, there you go. You get base level of Heartwood Amulet and Sovereignty, but you don't get as much health. You only get 100 health from them, and you get the same amount of protections on the chainmail that you do get on Mark of the Vanguard. So it's a more efficient item to get, you know, just 50 gold extra, but 50 more health and HP5 as well is super insane at that level. Plus the passive as well, while not necessarily as strong in this stage of the game, is still something to note.
Yes, that 5 damage reduction can make the difference, and Avant-Garde do have a lot of burst, especially that I'm a Monster. If that I'm a Monster does connect onto Weave and he doesn't have anything up, that could be the difference, especially if the field's a lot. There are so many different ways Avant-Garde can try and combo their massive AoE ult into Deadweight. So even just that extra little bit can really mean the difference.
Mid lane now, we got a 4-man grouping at Deadweight as Shred is hiding around the corner here. Avant-Garde, 3 of them under the tower, playing very, very defensively at this point, which is kind of what you don't want to do. But Shuckles, going to deal some damage here, only got a solo, pops the shield. Weave tries to land the knockup, but doesn't quite get it. Shuckles dashes away here. We see a 1v1 actually on the left-hand side. Rob Diggity up against HS, and HS definitely getting the better of this thus far. But Rob Diggity does have that sustain with the Cupid heals.
However, over in the solo lane, we do see the 3 space on time as well as the dazzling offense from Chuckles to try and back away and get out of the aggression a bit, but Weave is not having any of that. Divine Judgment comes out and Shred throws down the boulder, and that will be what is needed to secure the kill.
2-man taunt there from Gruff. In comes Mouse. I'm a Monster, doesn't land on anyone. So HS takes down Rob Diggity over in the duo lane, and the fight is continuing here in the mid. Only got a solo left alone here. Crush does so much damage. Good knockup from Weave. Liquid Renegade in a little bit of trouble here. Manages to get away. Gruff looking for Shred.
And now the scoreboard is reading 5-1 at 10 minutes. Deadweight are absolutely comfortable while they are. Every single lane has basically been able to win out. And basically they forced Avant-Garde into a less aggressive playstyle. Last week against Corviday, we saw them play a much more aggressive. They were invading buffs, they were showing how much experience they had. But this week, Deadweight are the ones bringing the play.
Oh, Gold Fury, Contestian, Mouse trying to steal the crush a little bit too early as Deadweight take that one. Triple bounce, Steely lands, but Chuckles falls down to HS. Shred in between two members here. Unstable Vortex does some damage, but Shred's in a lot of trouble. But Weave is here, trying to help him out. The dash, there's the dazzling offense now as well. Shred, so low here, but the healing is keeping him alive for now. El Chuckles portaled through, only good to solo his Disruptor Gruff. And now Chuckles is the one being turned on. Liquid Renegade picks up one, but Shred takes down Chuckles. There's the Divine Judgment coming up from only good to solo. Gruff, so low and so slow. Shred doesn't land the knockup. Only good to solo gets the kill. There's the Fields of Love from Rob Diggity, but only good to solo is continuing on. Deadweight win this fight. They take the Gold Fury and they take the kills.
Yeah, so we've been starting to see the power of Hercules in this fight. As you saw, he's just constantly sustaining. And whenever he took damage, he was just healing it back up no matter what. And most importantly, that Divine Judgment is going to wreak absolute havoc onto Avant-Garde if they don't pick up some Winged Blades. I especially expect to see Gruff possibly looking to pick up a Winged Blade just because the amount of slows coming out from Deadweight is such a potent threat.
Gruff's going for a Sovereignty here early, or at least I'd expect it to be a Sovereignty. Could possibly be a Mid-Guardian Mail. As I said, though, I really expect it to be the Sovereignty, just given the amount of physical damage coming out of Deadweight at this stage in the game, with a Hercules, a Nemesis, and a Ho-Yi. It's a smart pickup, gives his team a little bit more HP5 and physical protections as well, so I like this pickup. He has gone into those Traveler's Shoes, like you were talking about before, to make up some of that lost gold farming he's having by not having Watcher's Gift.
And what I'd really like to see for his third item, like third main item, would actually be a Heart of the Nemean Lion.
Solo lane, Shred, taken very low here. Liquid Renegade jumping in. There is the Fear No Evil. Liquid Renegade in concert with El Chuckles again picks up a kill on Shred. I can bet Chuckles is there in the comms just saying, you know, gank him, he soloed me. We can't let him get away with this.
Yes, Avada playing a very smart strategy. They're like, basically from what I can see, it's just target Shred, kill Shred. We need to shut down Shred. And it seems to be working. They actually are putting up a very decent fight compared to most of the other teams. However, you do need to keep in mind, from what I've seen from all the Deadweight games, their first game is usually a lot closer, and then in their second game, they figure out a team strategy and then just completely stomp all over them.
Take a look at the grass this stage in the game. 2,000 experience, 2,400 gold is the difference between these two teams, all in favor of Deadweight. The kills read the same way. I think with Solo being chased down here by El Chuckles, not too much going to come the way of this one, though. There is a big grouping here from Avant-Garde in the mid lane. Could possibly look for something, but instead going to go for their back camps.
Not just the grass are in favor. Having a look at the player damage charts, you can see almost the entire team of Deadweight, Agony, are actually on the top of the charts, while everyone else on Avantgarde is basically below them except for Chuckles. And with Shred topping the charts, I am not surprised at all. He's literally been in almost every single team fight. He's been a part of 4 out of the 7 kills that have currently happened.
Alrighty. Mid lane now, Gruff and Mouse looking to farm up here. Possibly can look for something on Agony. They haven't picked on him too much, but it is difficult to find a Janus out of position given the great mobility he has. And given the peel he has as well, Wii's actually used these belly flops really well. Belly flops onto Gruff there, just trying to keep him away from the rest of his team as a gank coming in on the left-hand side, but Agony positioned that one a little bit too behind his targets.
Actually, that was more of a counter gank. You didn't get to really see it, but Liquid Renegade was actually aggressing very hard onto HS during that time. Essentially what Agony did was, I'm going to shoot out three space on time just to alleviate the pressure. Tell Liquid Renegade, you can't just engage on my teammate without us appearing. We are going to rotate. We are going to protect our ADC in a HS.
Oh, look at this Deadweight flanky right here. They're using only good at solo as bait. Two ultimates use Weave, jumps over the wall. There is the crush, but Chuckles with that 50% HP. Only good at solo, just desperately trying to get away from Liquid Renegade. Pops the Sanctuary, keeps himself alive. Chuckles very low here. Mouse still full HP, so that's very important for Avantgarde. HS comes in with the Sunbreaker, looking for Gruff, who's going up into the sky. He's bursted down there. Absolutely destroyed by HS, and now it is 5 members to 4 in favor of Deadweight.
Yes, and now we see a pause coming through from Weave, but that was a very good team fight by Deadweight. And that final little bit of kill was partially due to the fact that Nemesis already has a Void Shield online, ensuring that when HS rotated over with that Sunbreaker, it was doing just that extra little bit of penetration damage, even though already has a Sovereignty online.
All right, we're back into it now after that pause. We could see actually Rob Diggity taking about 50% HP here, but going to be able to get away. So before that fight, we saw Agony use his through space of time. The thing about that is it's not a big team fighting ultimate. Chuckles get taken a bit low here as Deadweight steal away the red buff. Avant perhaps looking for something off the back of this. Armor Monster still available, but instead going to disengage. As I was saying, the through space of time isn't necessarily a big team fighting ultimate. You can use it to great effect. We've seen Chaos do stuff like that in the North American SPL, but it's not, you know, a be-all and end-all ability in team fights. If you're looking for big burst mage damage in a team fight in this composition, it's going to come out of the Bacchus's Intoxicate. So he can feel free to really just pull the trigger on that through space of time anytime, as you said, just to counter gank or stop the pressure that Avantgarde's putting on his teammates.
That's just the amazing thing about the three space and time. It's so versatile. As you said, you can either use it to attack, you can use it to rotate across the map. You can just use it for so many different tools, and that's why Giannis is such a top mage pick currently, for ever since he's been released, basically, just because he can do so much for a team and give so much back. Even though he has a lot of utilities here, he also has so much burst that he has the best of both worlds from a mage.
Hit 16 and a half minutes. 3900 is the experience difference. 3200 is the gold difference, all in favor Deadweight this stage of the game. Looking at only good at solo, you mentioned that Void Shield he's got gone into the Jotun's Wrath now. We've actually seen this kind of be a trend among junglers recently, going for that Void Shield before the Jotun's Wrath. The protection's just being, you know, too strong to pass up, but as well as that, the protection's shred, essentially, that it offers, it reduces the physical protection of enemies within a certain radius by 20, so it's going to mean the rest of his team is hitting equally as hard. Given the Nemesis passive and ultimate as well, it's going to be stripping away all the protections from characters and players like Gruff.
And then you combine that with Wii's Belch of the Gods providing anti-heal to shut down the Cupid heal, as well as the Amaterasu heal. You suddenly have a lot of ways to basically not just, shut them down, but also ensure that they can't heal back up once they've been shredded down, even though they have meditations.
Mid lane, Gruff and Mouse clearing the wave. Weave is hanging around the side here, clearing some wards out. Could look for something here as Agony's rotated back in. Weave's coming in from behind here. Gruff's spotted him out though, so Mouse is going to be able to get away safely here. I've really liked how Wii's been playing on this back, as I mentioned before, this is something he really enjoys playing. Bounces onto Mouse, there's a Divine Judgment. Mouse looking very low here, only got a solo, diving deep under the tower. The snipe, oh my goodness, that was a pixel off hitting Mouse, but Agony manages to get himself back through the wall and out of danger. My goodness, that was just barely off the mark.
And also over in the duel lane, we see HS again trying to solo off Rob Diggity, and even though he has those hearts, he's just constantly applying harass with the Ricochet, just landing those combos and throwing down the songs.
He Rub Diggity there, gets the Soul Eater passive and gets himself healed back up, but it'll be very hard for him to gauge on this next fight. And the Gold Fury is Gruff, is absolutely destroyed there. HS has claimed himself another kill, and now perhaps we'll see the second Gold Fury of the game as Deadweight is starting it up.
Even though HS's name may stand for half size, he's always been playing big this season. He's just been doing a great job in the carry role, especially on gods like Arnher and Huyi that he's been able to get a hold of right now.
Oh, Shred with the boulder over the wall there, takes down Liquid Renegade, and now there's a fight here around the Gold Fury Mouse. Isn't he yet? Rub Diggity very low on mana, not trying to hang around a whole lot here. Chuckles just trying to be a presence though and prevent Deadweight doing this Gold Fury before his team can get in position. Shred doing an excellent job of standing in the way. As difficult as that sounds, it is a key skill needed. There's the Divine Judgment again from Only Got Solo. Dazzling Offense comes in, the Crush as well, but it is only popped after Only Got Solo loses his shield, so he's down to about 50% HP. Gruff trying to find something here as El Chuckles is taken very low. Only Got Solo picks up kill. Good triple root there for Mouse, but another snipe comes through from Agony and takes down a whole lot of health from Avant-Garde. Deadweight again turn their sights to the Gold Fury.
That was an extremely good play by Ogre, which some people might have missed. Basically, what he was able to do was block the Glorious Charge by literally body blocking, just standing in front of it, ensure that El Chuckles just couldn't get near the Gold Fury, and Deadweight do indeed secure the Gold Fury.
Iron wants to lance over the walls, but doesn't do enough damage. Gruff got a good taunt there. Not enough damage at this stage coming out from Mouse. HS picks up Gruff. Mouse all alone in the middle lane. Rub Diggity and Liquid Renegade are coming in at this stage. Mouse trying to get out, but the driving strike is good. The boulder's better. Weave's basic attack in the end is all that's needed to secure the kill. Mouse falls down.
And now 4-13, raise the scoreline. 9, basically about to hit the 20-minute mark. Having a look at the grass now, we can see it is a 9,000 XP lead, as well as 6,500 gold in favor of Deadweight. Deadweight just looking to take this game number one very easily.
It's been a while since Avant-Garde's managed to get themselves a kill. I want to take a look at Mouse's magical power here. Only 217 compared to, well, it's not that much disparate from Agony, but still, just not really hitting like you'd expect Acilla to do. He has gone a fairly low magical power intensive build at this stage. The Warlock Sash not even halfway stacked up yet. He doesn't have the full spell focus into a Void Stone. So, you know, not going to be doing as much damage as he will in about 5 minutes time. But still, you know, Gruff set up very nicely for him there. Avant-Garde just didn't have the power behind them to finish it off.
Yes, Dewey did a really good job of shutting down Mouse early, ensuring he couldn't get online. The whole point of Scylla is that she's a glass cannon mage. She's there to deal out a lot of burst damage and then be done with it. Once she if she can land an armor monster, if she can land a crush, usually in the late game she does a lot of damage. But since she has been forced into this Warlock Sash and been denied a lot of farm, forced into very unfavorable team fights, she has just been forced so much further behind than what you normally would see from a Scylla.
Tier 1 tower on the right-hand side falls down. Rub Diggity, split pushing on the left-hand side, should be able to get a tower in return here, but it looks like Deadweight want to force a fight here at the tier 2. They've got HS in the mid lane who's pushed up a wave. Weave goes in, but doesn't find him with a knock-up. Snipe comes through from Agony and hits onto El Chuckles. The Intoxicate too early there from Weave, but Shred still picks up a kill onto Chuckles. Gruff dashing away here, only got a solo, dashing after him, takes a lot of damage, but he's not afraid at this stage of the game. He's just trying to keep the rest of the team away. Deadweight there won a fight there with only 4 members, as HS is in the middle lane, still looking to push down that tower.
And the Defender of Olympus actually has been forced out, as well as Rob Diggity getting picked up. Purification is used to keep him safe, and Deadweight now looking to retreat. They got 2 towers, no deaths on their side, they should be very happy. And now
they got 3 towers.
The Fire Giant.
Really, they got 3 towers there, because they got the 2 towers on the right-hand side, and HS pushed down the tower in the middle. Rob Diggity did get one in return on the left-hand side, but overall, very beneficial trade there for Deadweight.
Yes, and also, they're actually looking very close to get to 20. As we can see, Shred is already level 19 compared to El Chuckle's 17. Almost everyone else on the team is 17 and 17, bar Wave, and he's still doing 3 levels better than Gruff. They've just been constantly getting farmed from all these team fights so far.
Taking a look at the graphs again, 12,000 experience, 9,000 gold. The difference between these two teams, 10 kills as well, separate the scoreline here. So Deadweight very firmly in control of this one in the driver's seat. I almost said driver's street there. That's not a phrase. Driver's seat, and looking to just, you know, keep this game going in the direction that they want. Rob Diggity can't even defend his tower here. Only Good Solo uses that Divine Judgment and just forces Rob Diggity away. It means he can't even contest this tower.
And now a grouping from three members of Deadweight may even look to engage on this tier three. Belly Flop does come out, and the three space and time is available if they do want to get the whole of the team right back into this dueling.
What I really like about Deadweight is that they're not afraid to pull the trigger. They're not afraid to just use an ultimate when they deem it necessary. They know what their cooldowns are, and they know as well, you know, okay, this ability's down, we might not be able to fight as effectively until then. Weave goes in, Intoxicate Snipe comes out from Agony, doesn't land here. Chuckles teleports into the tower, there's the Fields of Love. Gruff taken very low here, but manages to get away from most of the damage. Only got a solo chasing after a mouse. There's the Iron Monster, but a beautiful Sanctuary from Agony keeps himself alive. Tier 2 tower on the left-hand side falls, and Deadweight still looking to push their advantage here. Crush comes out from mouse, but doesn't do as much damage as he'd like. There's a Dazzling Offense from El Chuckles, but Gruff still falls down despite the bad efforts of his solo laner. Liquid Renegade cops the Divine Judgment again. Good three-man rip from mouse there, gets the Crush off, but doesn't manage to kill anyone here. Deadweight, all five members still alive.
And now, all five members as well as a minion wave are ready to go into that Phoenix. If they want, they could possibly look at Shred, easily tank that Phoenix with that Gauntlet of Thieves and his mitigate wounds.
Yeah, Shred just healing back up here, already over 50% HP again. Deadweight backing out slowly here, looking to go back, buy some items, and then press their advantage. Also, they got what they needed from this fight. There's no reason for them to push their luck.
And now El Chuckles is kind of moving in as the Burn of Olympus is used onto Liquid Renegade as they're trying to force and try and find something onto Deadweight, but the Driving Strike is just too strong.
Liquid Renegade, before he can even get anything off here, takes so much damage. He's already at death's door, basically. Gruff here looking for only good at solo, not going to find him. Chuckles just frontlining desperately, trying to keep his team members alive. But two men pull there from Shred. Dazzling Offense again used by El Chuckles. Stuns out too, but there's no follow-up damage here as Avant Garde are just trying to retreat. Gruff though, now the target of the damage, and HS picks up the kill in concert with the rest of his team. Deadweight now looking for the tier 2 tower in the mid, and I don't think Avant Garde's got enough in them to contest this one. Links.
Nope, and once this tower falls, that'll be the final tower to fall on the side of Vanguard. Having a look at Deadweight though, we can see five towers are still up, with the only tower to having fall is the Dui Lane tier one. One of the, you could say, least important towers. The ones you really want to take down are those mid lane towers just to open up the map. And you can see why Deadweight just had complete free reign over the map, especially with their level advantage. However, Avant-Garde looking to try and bring that lead back with this Gold Fury.
I like this call here. They're going to try and get this one away while Deadweight's all back in base, buying their items and, you know, all the rest of the things you do when you back. Avant-Garde take that one pretty cleanly. They warded it effectively, but they actually used two wards there on that one. So a little bit of a misplay there, but they're not going to worry about that too much. That's very confidence boosting for Avant-Garde as well. They managed to get the Gold Fury, bring some more gold and experience into their coffers. So, you know, perhaps this is a step in the right direction for Avant-Garde. By no means is the tide turned in this game, but Avant-Garde definitely showing signs of life.
And now Avant-Garde, they need to bring their attention towards that Fire Giant, because if Deadweight get their hands on Fire Giant with this level lead, that will be what closes out the game. They already have a lot of sustain, especially on people, as we mentioned, like Shred, who can just heal constantly, and once they get Fire Giant, they will basically be unkillable.
Douglas here knocked up into the air. There's the Intoxicate. Good portal from Agony as well. Where did he go? He was half health and he disappeared. Now Deadweight looking to press their advantage. Rob Diggity force away. Good. Fino Evil peels away Deadweight from the rest of Avant-Garde. Shred going through the portals here. But as you mentioned, Lynx, Deadweight looking straight for this Fire Giant. And they should be able to do this one. 5v4. Only four members of Avant-Garde able to contest this one. And you know, it's going to come down to a steal for Mouse, I feel, with the Iron Monster. But he's not going to be here in time. The damage is too much from Deadweight. They take down the Fire Giant. There's Mouse with Iron Monster. Monster off the mark and sanctuaried away anyway from Agony. Gruff falls down to HS Agony, trying to fight 2v1 here, but he's winning the contest against Mouse and Liquid Renegade while the rest of his team takes down the rest of Avant-Garde.
And now Agony doesn't need to be careful though, as Liquid Renegade has gotten very low there. The passive, but however, Ogre able to pick up a kill onto Rob Diggity, and HS has rotated over to save his buddy all the way over in the duel lane he's been forced to run.
Liquid Renegade over the wall, managed to get himself out alive. Just still looking for him here. Can he find a triple bounce? No, he's not going to go for it. He's going to instead look to push up the wave on the left-hand side. Actually, he stopped him from backing down. I thought he might have got the kill. Wasn't able to get the angle, but Deadweight looking for this tier 2 tower in the mid. Then I expect him to either go for the middle Phoenix or the left-hand side Phoenix.
Well, the thing is, HS didn't really need to get the kill. That play there, just stopping him from backing, meant that defense on the tier 2 there was just perfect. And now Deadweight looking to initiate.
There goes the bowler. Great four-man taunt there from Grub. There's the dazzling offense as well. Really good combination of CC here from Avant-Garde, but the damage just isn't enough to follow up on that CC. Crush comes through from Mouse, but only good at solo, heals up all the damage, and Shred, just the healing monster that he is, as Hercules doesn't seem to be taking any damage at all. Henshin now turned to the left-hand side, Phoenix, by dead weight, Avant-Garde trying to contest this one, but Shred, the monster that he is just standing in their way, and nothing's gonna get through him.
And as they're doing that, they're just slowly whittling down this Phoenix, as Avant are just trying their best, their hearts out, to stop this Phoenix from going down. Ogre getting extremely low.
Left-hand side Phoenix, bare amounts of HP, it falls down, HS picks up Liquid Renegade here, and now Deadweight, all of their members with Fire Giant, looking to pressure some of these waves in, going back now, clearing out the jungle. Once they pressure a couple of these waves in, they might back, buy, and then look for the final push and end this game.
With HS this game, he's been playing out of his mind, 8-1-3 currently, the top leading kills the entire game. I think we can start to say, because I've seen HS play a lot of Huyi this split, I think we can start to say maybe that HS has dethroned Rob Diggity as the Who Yeezers of OCE.
I think that's fair to say. I tell you who I'm more impressed with on the side of Deadweight, and it's someone I was talking about earlier, is Weave. 2-0-16, part of 18 of his team's 20 kills, 0 deaths at this stage of the game, and given that Barkus is such an aggressive support where you really need to put yourself in the middle of the action to be effective, the fact that he hasn't died yet is very impressive to me. Okay, as well, 4-0-11, part of 15 of the 20 kills, no deaths as well, and considering how aggressive he's been playing, that is very, very impressive to me.
He's just been doing a great job. Both Weave and Ogre have been pairing up together, using our Divine Judgment, the intoxicating belly flop to basically CC chain people to absolute death. And Avant-Garde just, they don't have the answers. And right now, especially still the Fire Giant buff is currently on Deadweight, they just can't respond to it. They don't have the damage. They don't have the sustain to out-sustain Deadweight. And now this third and final Phoenix is looking to fall.
Only good at solos in the middle lane, gonna clear out the wave a little bit and then come help his team. But they're looking to engage even without him. El Shuckles here, all of the way, a lot of damage onto him. Just barely able to survive, dashing under his own Phoenix. There's the through space and time from Agony and Liquid Renegade taken low as well. Only good at solo, dashing through, slice and dies, picks up the opposition jungler. And now Mouse in a world of hurt here, portal through here and exploded by Weave. Right hand side Phoenix falls, no Phoenix is left for Avant-Garde, and this might be curtains for them. 22-4, reach the scoreline, 30 minutes in, and the Titan is under attack. Down comes the Sunbreaker, and in comes Deadweight, looking to end this game. Agony picks up one final kill. Hey, Chesno says, I'm gonna get the last blood here. Titan falls down, game to Deadweight.
That was a beautiful performance. Deadweight, through this entire split, whenever they play, they always play their best. They never underestimate a side, and they always take a commanding victory to show that they are the number one in this split.
Avant-Garde there, they had a composition that they liked, they had characters that they liked, but just unable to execute on their game plan. Deadweight, however, were able to do so. So that is 1-0 to Deadweight thus far. We're going to go to a short break here and be back with game number 2 between Deadweight and Avant-Garde.